the next panel in this session. We have a number of people with very long resumes and very long lists of awards, so I'll keep it short because we're running a little behind. I don't want to take any time. But I'd like to call the chairman of the panel, the director of IIT Madras, Professor Bhaskar Ramamurthy, who doesn't need much of an introduction in this building, but just I want to remind us of two points about his career. One is that he was a founding member of TenET, which is a group that has already demonstrated significant success in technology and policy in the area of communication networks in India. Not only the networks, but also a number of innovative technologies that are built to leverage these networks. Second, I wanted to remind him of a statement that he made in 2011 upon coming director, that the Institute, that is IIT Madras, will continue to focus on fundamental and translational research given the development imperative of the country and find solutions to the pressing problems facing society. I think that sums up much of the intention behind the center and just wanted to say that this is the continuation. So Professor Bhaskar, if you'd like to come up and start to populate the stage, then I was calling you up to the stage, but that's okay. Second is we have also from IIT Madras, we have the other sort of, I'd say, within the Institute founder of the center, Professor Ashok Jhunjhunwala, who really needs no introduction given, where is he actually?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, so he's right over here. Really needs no introduction in this building, the IIT Research Park. But I just want to flag a couple of things. One is that he is a founder and a member, an active member of the governing board of most of the innovative institutions here on campus, ranging from the TenET Group, World Technology Business Incubator, IIT Madras Incubation Cell, and I hope that CTAP kind of joins the ranks of these groups. He's also a member on the policy side of the Prime Minister's Scientific Advisory Council and has served on countless technical and policy committees for the Government of India, Reserve Bank of India, Confederation of Indian Industry. So with that, Professor Jhunjhunwala, if you'd like to join on the stage. We have two other members of the next panel. There is Sudeep Jain. Currently the chairman and managing director of the Tamil Nadu Energy Development Agency, which is responsible for formulation and implementation of energy policy on wind, solar, and bioenergy. This is the culmination of a long career in various leadership positions in rural industries, departments of youth affairs. And one interesting fact is he is also the organizer of the world record in planting the most trees in 24 hours in Nangapattinam district when he was the collector. So for that, thank you. You'd like to join us on stage. And last but not least, we have Mr. KK Raman, who is currently partner in the Rezone Investment Advisors Private Limited, a group that works in real estate and logistics projects. In particular, he's spearheading an effort to build a low-cost green township along with the Olympia Group. He's also an alumnus of the IIT Madras and earned an MBA from IIM Calcutta. And is most recently also was the executive vice president and zonal head of DLF Limited. Additional fun fact, a bird watcher, I'm told, and a member of TAI as well as the IIT Alumni Charitable Trust. So please join us on stage, Mr. Raman. Thank you.
That's all?
Yes, that's all.
Thank you, Jessica. So we're going to spend the next an hour or so looking at this a particular instance of a new technology or a new technological solution which seeks to address a major challenge in our country, which is the which is a consequence of the perennial shortage of electric power. And the consequence is that domestic consumers are subjected to varying hours of power cut or load shedding every day. How can one do something to mitigate this in the absence of being able to do the obvious, which is to generate enough power? And how do you channelize a certain limited amount of power to these people so at all times so that they can be assured of a certain amount of functionality which today's electricity brings? And how do you do that in a way in which it will actually create demand for energy efficient appliances so that the same amount of power goes much longer distance? And in fact, how do you incentivize decentralized generation of power all through probably one set of instruments? So there is technology here, but there's policy making, and they feed both ways. So we just want to, this is not so much a session on discussing the merits or making you aware of this new technology which happens to have come out of IIT Madras, but we're using this as a platform for us to understand how these kind of technology and policy interactions play out. But before I give it to over to Ashok to tell you about the basic, what the technology solution that is being proposed, I want to take a few minutes. Our Muralidharan, who's sort of heading the center, came to me and gave me a paper which he wrote in 1991 for a conference called The Electrification of Madras City, 1905 to 1914. I think he gave it to me simply because of this thing. And he, in fact, confessed to me that he has not read it after that. I was just glancing through it and I was absolutely startled to see that exactly 100 years ago, the same things were being discussed as we're going to discuss today. Right? So give me 2 or 3 minutes. It's just so interesting that I thought I should share it with you. I'm using this as a source because the literature survey that he did from the archives. So in 1905, you know, the license to operate a public electricity generation company in Chennai was given to Crompton and Company. And it turns out that Crompton Greaves, is very much involved in the current project, what he's going to talk about. And the Corporation of Madras was, of course, was the government at that time. And interestingly, they were debating the superior, you know, public lighting, street lighting, the superiority of most, it was all oil lamp based. And there was a debate, to bring in this new electric supply, you had to have a big consumer. One big consumer is street lighting, you know, guaranteed government consumer. So, but the debate is, you know, should we go for gas or should we go for electricity? And not settled at all. And the commissioners actually thought it is better to wait until it is definitely and decisively settled one way or the other, which is superior, right? So basically, their lack of knowledge of technological progress shaped the evolution of the government's policy at that time. So this is something we see even today, right? Not being able to make up our mind. And one of the commissioners said the existing system of oil lamps itself is good enough. You know, why do we need all these new technologies? Right? All you need to do is to, you know, enforce the contracts more rigidly, put new burners, improve the efficiency. But somebody else said, look, you know, the world is changing and if we don't catch up now, we'll never be able to catch up. All these things, you hear it every day. Yeah, but the same things the commissioners were going through. But by the early 1900, the government of Madras already sensed where things were moving and they'd already developed a scheme for installing electric lights and fans in some of their own buildings. And they made elaborate calculations on the cost and very wary of the correctness of those calculations. You know, the problem that he mentioned, not being sure of the inputs they were getting. Not many people knew what all this is about. And in the early 1900s, a scheme involving introduction of this kind of new technology made the government very cautious. You know, should we do it or should we not do it? And actually, it turns out that before 1905, when the license was given, electricity was actually being generated, but only by private individuals, probably rich people, using oil and steam engines for their own homes. In other words, this decentralized power generation that Sudeep Jain Teda talks about is already in place before the first public generation of electricity. But anyway, Crompton and Company got the first license in 1905, and the license said that they shall use a 3-wire continuous current, DC current system, with a pressure, a voltage of 450 volts between the outer wires and 225 volts between the outer wire and the neutral wire, and the neutral wire shall be earthed. So it said all this in the license. They were given license only for a DC system. And the city of Madras then began to receive electricity in 1909, took 4 years, from the Madras Electric Supply Corporation. Okay? But what's interesting, it's very interesting. By 1909, things started changing in the rest of the world. And less than 3 years, by 1912, this company wanted to move to AC. Right? So they were contemplating that, to supply alternating current at low voltage and at a frequency suitable for both light and power along with DC. Right? And the reason they cited was the development of three-phase alternating current electricity has reached and far exceeded that of direct current, as may be instanced by the introduction of alternating current in Bombay, Calcutta, and generally throughout Europe and America. Okay, so they applied. And what did the government do? You can guess. The supply corporation warned the government that they would have no alternative but to increase the price of the DC power unless they were allowed to do so. So they said, if you prohibit AC, we will increase the price. But what did the government do? They had their doubts. So the initial reaction of the government was negative. They said that in Madras, the greater part of the consumers are domestic consumers for fans and lights. And for that, their expert, one Mr. Greenwood, who comes up everywhere, says that the AC fan consumed twice as much energy as a DC fan. Ashok, this was in 1909. Okay. and therefore sufficient reason for the government not to allow conversion to AC. Okay. And as for lights, he said that the electric inspector of the government, Mr. Greenwood, has reasons to believe that there's no advantage on either side, AC or DC, except that the DC, current DC arc lighting is much more satisfactory. Okay. And the government also feared that a mixed system of AC and DC would only produce endless trouble and inconvenience to consumers. And the advantages of alternating current are only with the supplier and not with the consumer. In other words, it's only meant to benefit this car, not the people. So they said Europe and America are different, Chennai is different, so we will not allow. So they said no. But by the middle of, the middle of 1914, the company said they can't continue with this DC power and they have to be allowed. And they were so confident of the change, they actually built the AC power plant even before the license was given. They were so confident. And they made a fresh proposal in 1914. And by that time, they said that within the last 18 months, the small AC fan motor is so much improved that it is now equal to the DC fan, only maybe 10% less efficient. And this Greenwood guy is still around. And he says that no, it's not 10%, it's 25% of this fight was going on. And then finally, what did they do? There was no center of technology and policy. So they actually, this was in summer, so in Ooty, they constituted a committee, okay, of 3 or 4 people and said, get a picture of the state of the art and see whether some modus vivendi can be found for arranging for finding out the answer, to between this AC-DC problem, what to do. So the first question the committee dealt with was the difference in efficiency between AC and DC fan. And they discussed everything. Finally, this Greenwood said that, yes, I agree that in a few years, they will become as efficient as the DC fan of that time. So that is going to go away. And cost also will drop once So basically, the government of Madras sanctioned the use of AC current to this company in addition to DC. And in 1914, with the introduction of AC current, Madras Electric Supply Corporation entered a new phase of its evolution and finally became Tamil Nadu Electricity Board. Okay. So this tells you that whatever we are going to discuss today was there exactly 100 years ago in 1914. Ashok.
Thank you. Both Bhaskar and I, who are been part of this whole project. Sir, 10 minutes, can you wait? 10 minutes. Let us see something very interesting that we are. We're actually communication engineer and not power engineer. In fact, I did not know some of the facts about the fan. We will talk about it. We got into the area of power because when we used to go to the villages to try to install our telecom system, the only reason our internet cafe would not work is because of not having power. And our backup powers and this and that, and we're tired. And Chennai City was another place where we're suffering. And two of us kind of were pushed around, sort of saying, let's start working on power. There was one colleague of ours, Dr. Kumarwell, he was working on solar, and he kept on saying, come and solar will do a very interesting thing. So we started working on solar. Actually, I'll tell you in about 5 to 10 minutes, very quickly, some of the things that we went around. And I think we are very lucky with what we have come across. I think purely luck. I wish I had read that article earlier. But basically, let's talk about shortage of power. Shortage of power, India understands. But still, when we started working on it, we wanted to quantify shortage of power. And we very soon came across what is called power exchange in India. There are these power exchange where the producers of power sell power to the consumers of power. Consumers of power are the state electricity board. And we saw that every day the price goes from 2 rupees to 4.50 rupees, every day. And basically came to the conclusion that 2 rupees is when there is surplus power and 4.50 rupees when there is a shortage of power. Every day it happens. You open pretty much 4.50. We also actually figured out, well, 2 and 4.50 is not that bad. Why does the electricity board keeps on crying? Then we actually found out this was the power at the source of generation. By the time you bring it to and sell it to a consumer, you have to add 50 to 60% more costs. So the price start going up. And then we... little bit of research shows us that many, many days the prices shoots up to 12 rupees. And that's where the shortage started reflecting. By the way, this 12 rupees was about 2.5 years back. Last year, consistently in November, December, the prices have shot to 20 rupees per unit per unit prices. 20 rupees is the power at the source. By the time it will be delivered, it will be 27, 28 rupees, and we pay much, much less. So this was a picture that we got, and pretty much whatever people say, now we have surplus, we won't do this. Pockets here, there, rural areas as you go, power cuts are very large, and this is what we started looking at. Then the next very important thing, and this partly I'll sort of say my stint in State Bank of India for 6 years as a board member gave me to do computations of a different kind. And one, of course, I started looking at what does it cost? What does it cost a consumer? Grid, of course, we knew all the way to 4 rupees, sometimes even 2 or 3 rupees, but 4 rupees per unit to 9 rupees per unit. Because this research park was paying 7, 8 rupees. Otherwise, I would not have known that it goes up to 9 rupees per unit. This is the cost per unit power. As soon as, for example, power fails in this building, we turn on the diesel generator. We are actually paying through our nose in this research park. And I started looking at why. And suddenly we found the reason is diesel generator, because power cuts takes place plenty of time. And unbelievably, when I calculate the total cost of power, it came to 24 rupees. That is including the cost of the generator, the interest, depreciation, the maintenance, operations, and also, the other interesting thing that we found, the generator does not run at the full capacity all the time. And if it ran at 40% capacity, it went up to 34 rupees. And as soon as we saw it, sort of say, well, we are paying that and nobody recognizes that. All of us pay that. We don't make protest on that. Where, whom do we protest? I don't know who we will protest to. Then I thought batteries will save things. UPS, all of us in our rooms have using battery. Again, I calculated the total cost of the power for the battery. And I found for per unit of power, it cost a minimum of 12 to 15 rupees, actually higher than that. 12 to 15 rupees is an underestimate. I have not taken the cost of a charger into account. And then it cost at least 5 rupees to charge. So again, you are talking about 17 to 20 rupees. So, and this is the time we started when we started working on it. We actually sort of said, well, if I put solar on my roof top, I don't need transmission and distribution losses because I'll directly get it in my building and directly use it. And we actually did that and we found that if I directly use DC, it will come to around 5 rupees to 5 rupees 50 paise per unit. Again, taking into account all the long-term this thing. As soon as I convert to AC, I add another rupee. Not too bad, but 1 rupee I add. But I sort of saw that at 550, of course, is comparable to the best that I can get from the grid. And we realized that that is the way to go. But the question came, but solar do not always work. I mean, when the cloud come, solar is not there. And on power cuts, it will not work. So what is an answer to it? Where is the pull for the citizen? Why will citizen go and put it? That was a question that we had particularly for homes. And then we came across this DC. One interesting thing, of course, lighting is the first thing that we came across. We are moving towards DC. And DC LED consume very little power, about half to one-third of the power of the CFL bulb. And we typically can make a very nice tube lights like this, 15 watts it will take for LED. But we actually recognize this, that if I take 15 watts of AC, 230 volts, and then convert it to DC, because the LED only works with DC, my efficiency is very low, 50%. So I'm actually wasting all the power in the conversion. So this whole AC with LED doesn't really give me much benefit. It gives me 15-20% benefit. If I could directly bring a DC line, it will help a lot. So this is the first thing that we actually recognize. And the second thing came as a shock. I don't know how the technology has evolved since early 1900. We should trace it. But today, a brushless DC fan, not the old DC fan, a brushless DC fan came into being because of the power electronics revolution of around 2002-2003. One of our alumni apparently came with this IGBT, which actually enabled something like this. It consumes about 40% of the power of an AC fan. A typical fan consumes 70 watts. A DC fan consumes only 30 watts. We're shocked. We started working with the same company, Crompton Greaves, to make a DC fan for us. We actually helped them manufacture this. And today I have got plenty of these fans. They work 30 watts. What is more interesting, that when I run it on the lowest power, on speed one, the AC fan still consumes 60 watts. The DC fan consumes 7 watts. On speed two, AC fans consume still 63 watts. DC fan consumes 15 watts. And at full speed, it consumes 30 watts. And we suddenly realized, well, the same kind of efficiency is possible probably in refrigerator, in air conditioner, and we have started working on it. For example, we have just now building AHU here for this building, and we are seeing that we straight away get about 40% higher efficiency for the air handling unit for the air conditioner. And then electronics, that we knew all works on DC. Low power electronics. And when we convert AC to DC, I was shocked. I am using this HP, very latest laptop, has a 60% efficiency, 40% power goes. Similarly, when I use a cell phone, 60% power goes. Nokia phone, only 40% is used. And therefore, the question started asking, world switched over to AC power for transmission. Has time come to switch it at least at premises? The problem is, again, where is the pull to? You have to redo the wiring, you have to redo. How does one go about doing this? So these two things were hitting us. And Dr. Uma Shankar, who is also happened to be our alumni, who was a power secretary, we came here to this very room, and we had a presentation for him. He actually was shocked, but agreed with all the things that we had told him. He says, but where is the pull? If you need to create a pull, and you need to solve a bigger problem, power cuts in India. Power cuts is so bad in India, that is what is what you really need to overcome. So we had no answer, of course. Basically, he said, can you provide some minimum power to each home, even in adverse power situation? You solve that problem, bring your DC and solar along with it. And we had no answer. But I think from there onwards, we stopped. And it took us two and a half months, exactly around this time, February of last year to April. And suddenly, one after another, we're able to solve a problem. And we're lucky to come across a solution where we sort of say, on the existing network, existing grid, we can provide a limited amount of power to every home, even in load shedding. What are we doing? Basically, the power cuts are controlled by the substation, 33 kV substation. That is a place where supply, when it exceeds demand, the power is cut. Very simple. That's what it is done. When total supply exceeds demand, in some areas, 33 kV substation cuts power or does load shedding for individual lines. The basic thing that we sort of said, can we allow a small amount of power to continue to flow, 5 to 7%, maybe 10%, and cut 85%, 90%, cut 93%, 95%. We came with the concept of brownout instead of blackout. Can we bring in a brownout instead of blackout? Can we do that on existing grid? It should be small enough so that even in the worst power situation, not more than 5, 7, 10%. We are not talking about 20%. Because 20% may not be available. So it is not 83%, it's 93%. Then this free brownout power, it has to be distinguished from the normal power. Otherwise, it will be used like a normal power. So we say, well, finally we came to the conclusion that we'll do it at a very low voltage, 90 volts instead of 230 volts. It cannot be used in a normal situation. And then use this with energy efficient devices at homes. At home, separate it into two lines. One where you'll put this kind of, and separate it and use it for energy efficient devices. So that's actually the idea that we came about. Now what did we do? So basically this is what we did. 33 kV substation, whenever this is where the blackout switches are there, or where the power cuts are takes place. Whenever supply exceeds, where supply is less than the demand, the power cut takes place. We said instead of blackout, you will do a simple thing. One simple replacement, take either a tap from an existing transformer, add a small transformer, bring down the voltage by a factor of 2.5, draw only 5 to 7% of the power, and feed it onto the line. Now, there will be low voltage therefore coming, very low voltage coming. Now, with the low voltage, industry will cut it off. Normally, there is a low voltage cutoff they will use, and they will cut it off. At homes and offices, you will get the normal voltage and this low voltage. What do you do when you do come to the home and the low voltage? At home and low voltage, you will get this input, but you will supply two outputs. One at 230 volt AC, but this will be unlimited power. This is like current power. Plus, you will provide a second line, which will be 48 volt DC. It will be limited, but uninterrupted. The important thing, it will be a limited power, but uninterrupted. And this uninterrupted power will be used with DC devices. So therefore, even the small power looks large. It can go long distance. It can wire, it can actually connect to many, many more devices. And it's basically the devices that we are looking at, lights, fans, and electronics, including television. Television is electronics. So essentially, this is the idea that 230 volts come in. This is a 4.4 kV step down for the distribution transformer comes in, and two more minutes comes through existing smart meter and come to 230 volts. Whenever there is a low voltage, the AC line trips, simply because it detects a low voltage detector and trips. But in either case, whether it's a normal or low voltage, you put a programmable DC unit and you put a 48 volt, 100 watts and feed this. Now one will say 100 watts? What can 100 watts do? Well, we then actually started installing and we say three lights, two fans, one cell phone charging, it can do quite well. Alternatively, it can do three lights, one fan, one television, one cell phone charging. You can shut off one fan and turn on the television. Not bad for the lowest income homes. At least we are providing minimum three lights, two fans, and cell phone charging, or three lights, one fan, one LED TV or LCD TV, and a cell phone charging. And it can be installed incrementally, I mean one by one. And then 100 watt is small enough such that even if every home draws the full 100 watt, it can be found even in the worst power cut. That's the whole idea. You could have made it larger, but then it wouldn't be available. But what if it wants more? It has created a pull for DC devices. That's where we added something more. We sort of said, well, since we are providing a DC power, if you want more, you just add a solar unit out there. And suddenly your 100 watts can become, and this can become 200 watts, 250 watts, 300 watts. You can put a small battery also out there. And once you have something like 225, 250 watts, you are going to be able to put four, five lights, four fans, largest television, cell phone, laptops, tablets, and you essentially even the upper middle class homes. Your AC won't run, your heaters won't run, this thing won't run, but otherwise things will work. This is finally what we actually got. And AC will, of course, continue whenever there is no power cut, but when there is a load shedding, it won't do. So you can go now. I know that you have to go. Huh? So this is the basic idea with which we essentially did that. Well, two more slides just. Since then, we have been continuously innovating. So what did we do? We actually built the whole thing. We built it, first installed it in our lab. Then we installed it in one demo home. And now we have installed in about 5-6 homes in campus, 3-4 offices, and everything we checked out working quite well. There is no issue in technically in terms of working. Once that got done, we kept on innovating in the meantime. How can we improve this? Can we do something better? For example, that's where Raman came in. And there are a few others who came in. Sort of saying, we are building complex. Maybe we'll install such units in every home. We came one step further saying that, well, if you're going to install in a building complex, we can probably do even better. Let's assume that your 11 kV line comes to you and you have a distribution transformer from which you get the 440 volts. It is here, instead of at every home converting the power to DC, we'll convert the power to DC at a single place for all the homes. So if there are 16 homes, we will convert 16 into 100 watts. Little more than 16 into 100 watts. We'll also add a solar panel out here. Because now, for all homes, solar panel can be added, a small battery can be added, and maybe an AC-DC converter is also added, because when the AC power is there, you can actually draw that. And instead of 100 watts, you can actually give 400 watts to each out of flat. And if you can give 400 watts, practically I can't think of 400 watts DC, you can actually use anything more than that. Five, six lights, five, six fans, couple of televisions, couple of laptops, cell phone charging, tablet charging, you can actually do that. And then we came across another very interesting idea. Sort of, and in talking to some of the builders, so when you get this 11 kV line for the building, you can need not even depend on the telecom, because depend on the electricity operator to actually do this load shedding and convert it to a 90 volt. You don't need to do that. You can tell them that give me a separate line. I will manage the load. Whenever you give me a message, I will switch over and draw only 100 watts per home. Whenever you say no brownout, I will go back to the full load. So essentially, you can very easily, you can do this. And at this point, you design a very simple unit, what's called a brownout messaging system. So you receive a message. You can even receive it as an SMS. You can receive it as an internet message. The second you get the message, you actually cut off the AC line. And the, however, a DC line, which is 100 watts per home, continue to work. Of course, if you have solar panel and battery, and all this can become 400 watts. The minute you say normal restored, you can go back, and AC line and DC line both can be done. This is what we actually are building, and we are hoping to install it in their place, in our own buildings, and I think we can actually make it such that no power failure really takes place. Now, I'll just take the last 2 minutes to talk about some of the policy relevance. The first important thing about idea like this, something like this, it requires minimal investment for either government, that is, I'm talking about being the distribution companies, or the citizen. The existing meter have to have either a replacement meter or you need a small unit at home, which is AC-DC conversion. We estimate the price will be around not 2,500 rupees. That was in our old design, more like 1,200 to 1,500 rupees per unit. And you can also do, of course, time of the day metering, etc. Minimal change in existing power, incremental addition of devices. That's the main thing. It also generates a huge pull for these DC devices. Because now, suddenly, only with DC devices you can actually use this in an effective manner. So you suddenly create a market for DC devices. You create a, therefore these are energy efficient devices. This is something that anyway the India has been wanting but just have not succeeded. You also create a huge pull for decentralized solar production because the solar enables you to add your power to 400 watts. So even upper middle class homes can have it. And even smaller homes can start putting smaller installation and do something like this. It, of course, can help you manage subsidy. Now the government can come and say, this 100-watt unit, I will subsidize. The other one, AC, I will let it go to market rates. Now, if that happens, the whole power distribution company will actually financially buy back. And it generates huge citizen goodwill. Further, for housing colonies, policies that allow decentralized power generation, use energy-efficient DC devices, allow them to use a limited power on receiving load shedding signal, this very thing that I described. Very simple change in policy enables you to start moving in a totally different direction. They are doing their own load management, but under your control. And you can make sure that they are doing it. If they are not doing it, if you find it is not doing it, you can actually withdraw that kind of facility. The other great thing that I see in this manner, if you think of 100 million homes out of our 250 million homes can add about a kilowatt of decentralized solar, you are talking about addition of 100 gigawatt. Now, 100 gigawatt is 40% of today's capacity. And this can happen in relatively very, very short time. So something like this enables you, what I'm trying to say, technology is open possibilities. That's one of the key things that we are trying to point out. And of course, you need a lot more R&D on new DC energy efficient devices. We have come up with some, but I think much more needs to be done. And finally, I'll sort of say we need to really work on this electric vehicle. Because once you move away from this shortage of power situation, our biggest energy problem will come from oil. Because we continue to import, our oil bill has gone up by a factor of 8 times in last 10 years. If we continue to just do that, we are going to be in big, big trouble. So what I'm hoping is that really, really move towards electric vehicle. And I think by and large, the electric vehicle technology is well in our control. We can move there. There is not a shortage of electricity. I think it is almost in the situation that we can move there. We can finally gain rather than lose. A little bit of support, a little bit of push, and we can get there. Well, that's all that I will say. And I'll stop there, and we'll have the panel continue.
Thank you, Ashok. And so I think he gave you a picture about what this solution, this technological approach is all about. It's fairly simple that I think it's accessible to everybody. You don't have to be, this doesn't involve any very deep knowledge of electrical engineering. And in fact, it has more issues related to how do you enable, how do you make sure, you know, enable changes to happen such that people will move to more efficient appliances. The investments that are called for in that are very large, but millions of people make those kind of investments routinely on a day-by-day basis for various things. So it's a question of policy. How do you enable them to generate some of their own power? Again, it's not as if it's at an economic disadvantage. In fact, the cost of that power is comparable to what they are paying to the grid and more assured. And therefore, how do you, in this process, solve our power crisis? And in fact, if you look at it, I'll give you one calculation, which he didn't give you. The DC fan, once it's made in large volumes, will probably not cost any much more than an AC fan. But even at today's cost, because of the low volumes, where the cost is some few hundred rupees higher, even 700-800 rupees higher, actually, if you look at the power savings from 70 to 30 watts, about 40 watts of power that you save, the capital cost for generating 40 watts for the government, just the capital cost, forget the fuel operating cost, is 80 rupees a watt. So it's about 3,000 rupees the government has to invest to generate 40 watts, even if you assume there are no transmission losses. So you can see that there are a lot of policy issues to consider here. Do you want to incentivize people to shift to actually replace their fans? Do you want to actually give an incentive to them to do that so that you have to generate less power? So there are all kinds of questions that are have to be addressed in policy making. Decide how aggressively you want to go in. It's a no-brainer that you should go to more efficient devices. The question is, how aggressively do you want to do that? How much do you want to incentivize it? How much do you want to force the pace? These are the kind of questions that will come up. So I'll now request, what I'll do now is I'll ask Mr. Sudeep Jain to talk to us. He's been, in the last few years, in this current position, he's been really pioneering the use of solar energy, particularly solar photovoltaics in Tamil Nadu through his Tamil Nadu Energy Development Agency. We have had a lot of interactions with him. IIT has an MOU with TEDA. And we know that he's really, gone into the, very deep into understanding the issues. So he knows, Tamil Nadu announced the rooftop local generation policy last year. So he knows the ins and outs of this. We'd like to hear from him what, his perspective on things like this, interventions of this kind, where new technologies sought to be introduced, which could change the dynamics, but then policies have to be changed, and then policies can also change the way the technology is. If there's a policy, it turns out that there are some aspects of policy that cannot be, that have to be done in a certain way, then it may turn out that the technology may need tweaking. So this is really what we want to try to understand or try to expose, that these are the kind of things the center will grapple with. So I'd like to ask Mr. Sudeep Jain to tell us about his perspective on something like this.
Thank you, Professor Ramamurthy. At the outset, let me first congratulate the Center for Technology and Policy. It's definitely a very, very big felt need. As in the inaugural address, it was already mentioned, we do grapple many times with the decision-making process not having adequate information on the various options. And because of that, obviously, if we do not have the full knowledge, the chances that we'll come up with a proper decision may be very, very limited. So, and within the government, it becomes very difficult to have in-house teams which can give these options. Because we are not researchers, we are not policy. We can make policy, we can look at the various options, but we do need the academia and the industry to feed us with the various alternatives, and then a neutral decision in the policy can be taken. Coming to this specific project, I have been very keenly following this ever since I came to know of this and I saw the first presentation. And personally, I'm very confident that yes, this is something which needs to be backed, which needs to be supported to see that it succeeds. Technologically, yes, already demonstrations have been tested out. It is going to work. The issue is, how do we scale it up? How do we ensure that it's able to be taken to the scale when we are looking at 100 million houses? How do we reach there? Now, only issues, again, what comes, we have to see the entire ecosystem in which the government functions. whenever we have any new technology or new concepts being tested out, which obviously any new thing has always a chance of a failure, and any scaled up thing, if it fails, then in a public system, in a democratic system, we cannot answer, we cannot defend. So it's very critical that we first do the pilots, we test it out thoroughly, and if that is giving results where there is no chance of technical failure first, then we come to the behavioral part, the social part, whether the adoption will happen, whether it will be felt to be something good and the society is going to adopt, or whether there will be behaviors which could lead to the entire project collapsing. So I'll just do some of say the devil's advocate part. Professor Jhunjhunwala has, I'm sure, gone through most of those things along with the entire IIT team, but I'm saying just still trying to think of what can be the questions on to brainstorm. One doubt which I have in my mind right now is, while we'll be supplying a low voltage with the presumption that a certain capacity of the consumption only will happen, say 100 watt if we are talking about, and again the presumption that other AC equipments will not function because it's so low voltage, is there a possibility that innovations will happen and we'll have step up transformers coming up in every home and every building, where from 90 volt we are again back to 230 volt? What is the chance of that, and how do we ensure that it doesn't happen? Because if we are not able to technically stop that, then I don't think in a regulatory manner we'll be able to stop it. It's just like, why did the inverters come up in the first place? We all today know that inverters are not solving power problem at all. In the macro level, it is only wasting power. It might be giving us, we are able to draw, we are probably richer, we are powerful, we have more resources, so we can draw and save it in our building, in our inverter, thereby ensuring that those who are not equally affluent cannot draw any power at all. So inverters were never a solution, but we are seeing every house, every building, every middle class and upper middle class, upper class, everywhere inverters are there, every government building inverters are there. So how do we ensure that nothing like this comes up which jeopardizes the entire objective of seeing that only 10% or 15% or 5% power is drawn when there is a demand supply mismatch? So that is one very key area where I would want brainstorming, I would want exploring whether any such thing can happen. And if you're able to really find that yes, this is not going to happen, then this can be a very good solution. I would also want that yes, to sell the idea within the government, across the states, in the central government, we need to also do an estimation of how much power will be saved, what will be the total savings versus the total investment which we are proposing in this. Now, investment may be on the consumer side, investment may be on the government side, but ultimately it's an investment which consumer only will pay. Even the government investment is paid out of consumer through taxes or whatever means. So what is the total investment versus what is the total savings we are going to achieve? We need to do some analysis and then bring that point also in the debate. The next one which I would want again to check up is, as I think in the beginning itself it was mentioned, that this entire experiment, this entire proposition is on a premise that there will be power cuts. Now, I know as a country as a whole, we will still have some more years before we can really be sure that there won't be power cuts. Tamil Nadu, we are confident that the problem of power cuts is already of something of the past. We may not have this problem in the future. But still, yes, as a larger role to play by the technology, by IIT, by the industry, we need to look at the country as a whole. But at the same time, we also need to debate, by providing these shortcut solutions, are we delaying the demand for a complete solution? Whether this would, because we brought in inverters, so the decision makers were comfortable, they were able to always have power in their house or office, the influencers were always comfortable with either DG sets there. So are we, by providing these shortcuts, are we going to delay ensuring that there is a 100% uninterrupted power supply across the country, every house, every village, everywhere? And it is not impossible. It might be difficult. We have been grappling with it for decades, but it is not impossible. Can we also debate on that? So these are some of the points which I would want to be debated as a policy and technology interface area. And I'll be looking forward to answers as well as more suggestions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Sudeep Jain. I think that he's right, absolutely. These are the kind of things that come up, you know. As somebody asked in the earlier talk, what about the consumer? What about, so what is the chance that the consumer will do something which will come and hit the new approach at its very core? You know, for example, he only talked about putting step-up transformers. What if new air conditioners are sold in the market which work from 90 volts? Okay, things like that. So we have to address, those things have to be addressed in any of these technologies. The second point, you know, that he made is, what is the financial, the whole business plan, if you want to call it that, what, you know, investments versus returns. That's a fairly straightforward thing to do. And the last one is interesting, and that is, do some things like this actually delay the what you might call the better solution or the long-term solution. So these are just examples, I think. I'm not going to take it up right now, but we can come back to it. But I think these are the kind of things that we really want to address in this center. And there will be many more. But I think he just gave a few examples. We'll come back to these towards the end. I think some of them, the answers can already be given. But the purpose is not to actually figure out all the answers for this particular solution right now. The purpose is to bring out that these are the kind of issues that we have to deal with, that, you know, it's just basically developing a technological solution out of a laboratory and even demonstrating it in the field, as we are doing now, is only one part of the story. You know, there's all these other issues for which the center was set up. I'll now request K.K. Raman to give us the third perspective before we can discuss some of these questions. Some answers, as I said, we can probably attempt to give even today, but some others we may not be able to. Mr. Raman comes to this from a different perspective. So as a part of a company that is trying to build a big township, I mean, a fairly big township, ab initio. So we're not talking now about replacing anything. This is a new set of houses. What does he see as the role for this kind of technology? There are also other technologies that they are looking at, including our affordable housing technology, but that's a different matter. What is his perspective from a user angle? So we're talking about the consumer here. This is the one-step intermediary to the consumer, which is actually the builder who's going to give the solution to the people, to the consumer. What is his perspective on some new out-of-the-blue technological intervention like this to a very critical problem that is faced by his consumers, which is, what about power supply? If you're building a township, are you going to put a DG set? Are you going to give me assured backup? Or do we know, so that I don't have to have inverters? What are you going to charge me for all that? These are all the questions they have to deal with. So what does a solution like this mean? What are the questions that arise, particularly from the consumer viewpoint? This is what we'd like to see Mr. K.K. Raman reflect on.
Thank you. Can you hear me? Thank you, Professor Ramurthy. See, over the years, the real estate industry itself has undergone a number of changes. If many of you may remember, about 30 years ago, if a builder gave possession of your flat, the customers were very happy. I got possession. And they used to have mosaic tiles, or the gray mosaic tiles. A premium builder would give white mosaic tiles. So customers were very happy with that. Then came a company called Spartek. So this guy is a premium builder because he's giving Spartek flooring. That was the next phase. This way, as both the builders and the consumers evolved, today a flat buyer is a totally different animal from what he was 30 years ago. He is extremely demanding now. 30 years back, you just gave a building or a flat and said Tamil Nadu electricity board will connect it to your house, After that, it is between you and Tamil Nadu Electricity Board. That was acceptable. Today, no. The flat buyer says, I don't care whether the government has got supplying power or not, I don't know. I am dealing with you and I want uninterrupted power. So, it is not fully under the builder's control because the power supply is a monopoly of the state, practically, or maybe one or two sources. There are huge shortages. So, in between, the builder has to work as a buffer to chip in and give the customer all these facilities. So now then came the evolution of somebody started putting a small, you would have seen those small diesel generator sets. In fact, about 15 years back, some of the builders would just buy that one, you would have seen the diesel generator units kept in the balcony and in front of some shops. They'll pull one string and then it'll come on and that is connected. It'll run a couple of fans and a couple of lights. So the builder will say, okay, as a part of the cost, I'll give you free one such unit. You keep it with you. You run it, you operate yourself. That was the solution. And they said, no, I won't use it. There's a kerosene smell coming and who is going to pull this thing? Who is going to switch it on? I don't want to get into all these hassles. You give me something better. Then I think the diesel generator sets, centralized diesel generator set for the whole entire building came into existence. Then when we were building large apartment complexes, these customers said, oh, you got a diesel generator set in below my building, then I don't want the flat. Because it gives the fume smell. If I sit in the balcony, I get the fume smell. If I, there's a vibration. See, if I put a glass of water, the water is shaking. So, all the things the consumer started saying. Then what the builder started doing in the complexes, they started keeping the generator away from the buildings, somewhere else, with cork pad, buffer, and, vibration arresters and so on, and then run the cable from there, and then, so on. Then came the inspector of explosives. He comes and says, you cannot keep the diesel tank within so many feet of the nearest house. So the diesel set got moved further away. So, that is the solution which is going on now. So we are building a 113-acre complex and we are grappling with these issues, largely consumer-driven. So, at that time, we came in touch with IIT Madras and then checked with them whether some solution is possible. Now, here we have a solution which we are looking at where I think it is possible. It's possible in an ideal situation to totally eliminate the backup generator at all, entirely. However, of course, you'll have to incur the cost of running two lines on the DC. If you have a centralized system, a DC line and AC line, which is fine. But across the board, if you can cut down on the total power consumption of each household, and as long as I am able to provide uninterrupted power for common areas, and two fans and three lights or something like that, maybe one TV, that's okay till the power supply is resumed as far as the customer is concerned. So in 2014, a customer will accept the solution. I do not know in 2020 whether he will accept or demand something different. But I think for the current market scenario and the status of the mindset of the consumer as it exists now, I think we have got a very good technology in place which we want to try out. And I'm sure if it works, a lot more people will follow take it up. And another feature is there are many actors involved in the real estate industry. One is the consumer, the other are various suppliers, then you have a government making a policy and so on and so forth. They have also evolved. Government policy also has undergone a lot of favorable changes from what it was around 25 years ago. So I'm sure to facilitate the implementation of this idea in parallel while the builders are at it. Suitable policy frameworks will also evolve from the government side, from the technology people, technologies also will emerge. And we want to work with an institution like an IIT and use them like an R&D lab or something to support us and continuously evolve have a complete integrated solution. So I think this is the limited purpose of what we are trying to do. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Raman. You got an idea of how the whole, you can almost feel the pressure of the consumer on the builder, the way he speaks, the harassment that he faces, meeting all the clients, customers every day. And, but that's a good situation. That's what has happened because of competition. So basically, there is a tremendous pressure to try to come out with better solutions. And so what he's, what we heard from him is that if it works, the combination of this some amount of uninterrupted power from the grid, the possibility of putting solar. But the key to all of this is actually the fact that in large townships like this, they are already in the business of load management. You see, the traditional household is an unmanaged load. You just allow except at some very high levels. I mean, if you exceed 30 amps, the fuses will go. But that takes a lot of, you need really have to have enormous amount of loads to do that. So most homes, your load limiting factor is actually your purse. You don't want the bill to become very large. Otherwise, there's no limit. So from that situation, you have to go to a situation where you're managing your loads, having control about what you're consuming based on what's available. So if you don't want to go to the grid, if you want to depend on your own solar generated power, you have to be able to manage your loads. And this kind of a managed system, already in these large townships, they're doing to some extent because they're having these DG sets, this backup, these expectations of these consumers and so on. So in some sense, they are more mentally ready to go for these kind of solutions than a new consumer who's in an individual home who's not yet conceptually having the idea of managing his loads, except those who have inverters, because they know that they have a separate wire and they can only connect two fans, three lights, they know that. So it is in that sense, that part of it is not unknown to them. But somebody who never used an inverter in his home and is just using the grid today, the idea that you have to manage your loads, that there are solutions possible, provided you can guarantee that you won't overload the system. This is a new idea that has to be, and this is a huge amount of education you have to do. So, in the particular segment where he's in, which is large townships, there's an intermediary, the builder who stays on after the building is over to manage these utilities, who actually is already doing this to some extent. And for them to move up the chain and do more sophisticated load management is there's a distinct possibility this might work. So now we can go to some kind of a discussion phase. Maybe Ashok wants to say something and then we can, and then we'll come back. Yeah. So we'll now go to the audience for their comments and questions based on what they have heard. Yeah, please introduce yourself and then go ahead.
Hello everybody. My name is Piyush Sohani. I run a small social enterprise. We are incubated at Wilgrow. So we work in basically rural areas providing biogas solutions. The very simple thing, I like the idea. I mean, this idea is really good, but what I got is it is being discussed for the urban markets. I mean, urban people are already, they're able to afford inverters, they're able to, afford everything. It's the rural people who are not even, we are not even able to provide the simple lighting during the nights. Students are not able to read, they are not able to do basic things. So this kind of solution can be, if this can be implemented over there, will have much larger impact. Yeah.
I think better to answer.
Yeah, answer later.
Just go through one round, then we'll answer. My name is Shyam Sundar. Now, basically, I've got three questions. One, as he talked about the rural electrification, because one of the major political issues are how do you feed power to farmers for operating the pump sets? Maybe this idea could be looked at from an angle of providing cheap power and efficient power for agricultural pump set. Now, second thing is you talked about 100 years ago, people were thinking of going from DC to AC. Now, 100 years later, we are going the reverse, going from AC to DC. Now, he was talking about big townships How do you deal with this problem of low voltage, another one bringing 230 volts? How do you run ACs? So you're talking about a hybrid system where you're having both ACs and DCs. Why don't you look at it where in a township, all the flats will have only DC operated equipment. You bring the AC power up to that township. If it's a 113-acre township, you bring it up to the entry of that township and then convert everything into DC and have all the equipment in the house, because there's no point in my having an AC fan and a DC fan and then switching over and things like that. Maybe you look at an option whereby you can have in the entire building system, everything works only on DC. Basically, today you have ACs and all which are working on solar, which you hear the advertisement which says it's only 10 rupees a night when you run it for 8 hours and things like that. Now, the third issue which I think will become relevant is maybe 5 years, 10 years down the road, you will have the complete gas network coming into distributed gas network systems in cities and in small towns. Now, generating power using gas is, you can decide whether you want to generate all the way and produce AC power, or you do it in a restricted way and just produce. So, just like generating sets to which uses very costly diesel today, you use generating sets which will run on compressed gas or natural gas. And how you play around with it to produce only DC and how you can feed the thing, I think that's another thing which you should probably look at. Because the entire city gas systems can be given to every household where there is a generator which will run on that, and then you produce the power and give it to that. It may be a cheaper option. And as the government representative said, you are today looking at constraints which are there today. But a situation may come when the supply would be more than the demand. Then all these things would probably not be relevant. But of course, you have to solve today's problem, at the same time make it viable so that it doesn't become idle when the situation improves. Thank you.
Point out that you can, it's a light thing. We've been building battery packs for new applications like telecom, where we've seen, trying to demonstrate saving on fossil fuel. We have 8 months of feed study data that we have. For example, we're doing ATM and off.
Sorry. Okay. Use it closer.
You have a. And then run a charge of highly high capacity, high chargeable plate system, which can probably store and then use it for the solar irrigation and so on and so forth. In the process, we actually built prototypes. We built a solar virtual foldable folder which a girl child could use instead of running or burning the kerosene lamp. We built the 2 kilowatt solar panel which charges a battery bank which runs about 60 feet like as a premises lighting. And had a 3 days. These questions that we are talking about here, sir. I'm sure people like me and there are several others who are actually working on such models. The thing is, reach out to people like an RTBI or agencies like the TIDA, and able to build a sustainable or demonstrable, like when they say, pilots, which can probably be proven, so that we can then, when you work, when you scale up the system, these failures from the technical aspects could probably be ruled out or enhanced. So those kind of things, are they actually happening? I'm sure I gathered that today from some of the projects that Dr. Ashok just mentioned. NGOs outside would probably have a forum to be a part of this whole ecosystem where CETA would take these field data, we could probably take these experiences and then build these systems together. That is my point of concern.
Something so that you can have a complete picture. To some extent, what I wanted to say has already been voiced by Shyam Sundar. I won't repeat it. There is a good old, saying that necessity is the mother of invention and scarcity is the father of innovation. Maybe whatever IIT has done is based on these two things. Today we are a scarcity nation as far as electricity is concerned. And looking at it from that perspective, yes, this is a solution. Definitely this is a solution. But the reversibility of this is what he was talking about, and Mr. Sudeep Jain was also talking. When, what is the overall cost of this? See, supposing this is done in pockets, at different levels, one at the house level, individual residences and colonies, and at various places, when it is done, what is the overall cost to the economy? And whether that the country can afford, individually somebody may be able to afford it to, convert his fan or to buy a new set of fan and whatever. But as a policy, this is where this becomes a policy issue at the government level. Would you like to aggregate all these expenses and see what is in the overall scenario? You will yourself said that a few years from now, I hope what you said is right, power will not be a scarcity here. And when that scenario comes, what Shyam Sundar said is quite relevant. So, is this a permanent solution, or is it a solution like an inverter, which he said is not a solution? Or is it something more permanent, or does it take into account? Is it reversible? These are the questions that I want to ask you.
So, thank you very much. I'll try to. There are lots of different questions. I don't think that we can answer all the questions in short time in a convincing manner, but I think fortunately, this is not something that we have not been thinking about. Almost everything that is pointed out, we have been thinking about it for last 6 to 8 months. We have got into various. So I'll attempt to try to answer some of the questions. First of all, I did a very quick presentation. I think one of the key idea in this is to provide uninterrupted power. But the second very important idea is to save huge amount of power by bringing in energy efficiency. I think I think each of them can stand on its own. This energy efficiency is extremely critical. If you are able to bring energy efficiency and are able to consume only 50% of the power that is otherwise being consumed, that's a huge, huge, huge benefit. And it is national benefit. One can do the calculations. One has done something. The third is decentralized solar. The important point that I try to make is that trying to put a solar almost in every household, 100 million household, it kind of creates one of the best electricity that India can think of, at least in near future. Extremely environmental friendly, extremely and available where required, not having transmission and distribution losses about 30 to 40%, because you're directly using it. And if you're using it directly in DC form, it is even greater, because you don't have to convert from DC, because the solar PV produces DC, you don't have to convert it to AC, then again convert it to DC to store it in batteries, and again convert it to AC to use it. So that becomes a third very, very important part. So each of these three things stand on its own leg. Strictly speaking, I can argue, and I can even do economics on any one of the three bases. I'm not even talking about combining. Combining gives a huge, huge benefit and creates a huge pull. But on each of these bases, things stand. Because if India can generate 100 gigawatt and tomorrow 200-300 gigawatt using solar, 100 gigawatt in a decentralized manner, it can transform India. And one can calculate the cost. When we actually were doing all this, rural was very much in front in the mind. Our work initially started with rural. I pointed out that, and the complete solution is workable in rural. In fact, rural, it is even more needed because the power cuts are much worse. And so The first important point that I'm making, suppose tomorrow there is a power surplus. Well, fine. Still this can continue to work. It doesn't stop it from working. And the interesting thing is, you are saving huge amount of power by using the energy efficient devices, and at the same time you are generating solar. In fact, this will contribute to your becoming power neutral. This is the way. If you go in this direction, you will remove shortage. In fact, I don't see that for shortage will be there. Now, next thing is that then why are we talking about it? AC, DC, talking about having different things at the same time. I think the world is moving. I think first of all, if we do even a little bit of study around the world, this talk about DC, though we brought it quite independently almost a year back, is now caught on all the whole world. Everybody is talking about DC. The IEEE is coming with a DC standard for supply. The European Union is working on DC. United States is working on use. United States, there is a group which has already formulated standards for DC lines, DC devices. Why? Because whether we like it or not, LED does not work on, electronics does not work on DC. They don't use fans. But electronics and lighting are the two primary usage. In fact, cooling is less of a usage in the countries in Europe and United States. Primary usage is these two. Heating is a usage, but they use also a gas for heating. Primary usage is lighting and electronics. Electronics usage is increasing like anything. No electronics uses AC. Everything works on a low voltage DC. So everywhere the world is moving towards DC standard. Because they have put 24 volts as a standard. We are talking about 48 volt. We need to harmonize. We need to see whether what we need to do. So there is already 24 volt DC standard for the United States building, that they are moving towards that. The next important reason is that people do recognize this smart grids will have storages, small storages, because particularly as you start working on wind, start working on sun, it is not constant power supply. Coal, you can run the same amount of power pretty much throughout the day, not when it is a sun and wind and other renewable resources, even like converting the biogas and things like that. It will not give you a constant output. So you may have to use it sometime and produce it sometime. So there needs storage, becomes very important. And all storage one is working on is in DC, because batteries are DC. The second important thing is ability to add all this. There will be decentralized generations. Solar, could be biogas, could be wind. There will be decentralized generation. How do you add all that? For that, people are talking about hybrid solution. People are talking about AC-DC. The reason they are talking about AC-DC is because there are, first of all, AC is there. They are introducing DC lines. They are also talking about there are certain things which may have to continue to work on AC, like very high power air conditioners, like very high power heating. Even today, for example, people sort of say hairbrush. It's very difficult to convert it into a DC. Most other things, refrigerators will become DC. Small air conditioners will become DC. Mixer, maybe it will become a DC. Washing machine inside is already a DC motor. So there are people talking about two things being simultaneously. And today we can handle two things simultaneously. There's no reason why we cannot handle two things simultaneously. In fact, today, it won't be cost effective to convert everything as you bring in. We are talking about bringing in an AC line and then converting everything into, not everything into DC. For electronics, fans, lights, we are converting into DC. For air conditioners, lifts, let it be AC for the time being. Tomorrow, can we gradually convert them into DC? We can actually do that. So, if we become surplus, well, I will welcome. In fact, this will push us towards becoming surplus. This is the first question that was asked. What if somebody taps? Now, first of all, are we talking about tapping at your home or are you tapping on the street line? Now, if you're tapping at your home, there are fuses. They will essentially ensure that you can't draw more than 100 watts. If you're tapping on the street lights, well, today also you can. That's illegal. You can also tap today and draw as much power. And today some amount of tapping is done. And people are using it, tapping and using it. So people could tap and use it. But tapping and using will become more difficult with the solutions that we are proposing. Why? Because the voltage can suddenly fall from, you are tapping a line. You don't know whether it is what. Suddenly go from 230 to 90 volt. Maybe your device will continue to work with it. And suddenly it will, you have to put a up converter and bring it back to 230 volts and make it work. Suddenly the power may be restored and it will go to 230 volt. Your 230 volt will become 700 volt. In an instant it will become 700 volt and it will burn the device. In fact, tapping will become much more difficult. Now, can you build intelligent device which can try to detect that and then again switch? Well, stealing is a different problem. Can happen. Can people can come out with smarter ways of stealing. Those who come with smarter ways of stealing till the electricity board catches them, there will be. What will happen in the worst case if that happens? Well, that whole line fuse will go off. That line will go off. Now, of course, when that goes off, there is somebody who is stealing, and then gradually you will have to actually eliminate people. And people are stealing with this sophisticated gadgetry. Ordinary stealing will go. Sophisticated gadgetry stealing can be possible.
Basically, I think this is before the meter.
So you can't do it legally.
In fact, we are doing, so illegal things that we are doing. I can go on. There are a lot of things. Very interesting point that I wanted to make. I know. Last one thing that I want to do. We have done some computation. Bhaskar did a very hand-waving calculation, 50 rupees or 80 rupees per watt and how much will we save. We have done some computation. Huge benefit. Of course, we need to do this more systematically. And sometime with Sudeep, we will walk you through those calculations. What does the nation gain? We can think of nation or state gain, and what does it lose?
If you remember,
agriculture, water pump, we are talking about, we are working on it as a separate issue. We like to again separately discuss that.
See, if you remember,
we are also working on last one thing. We are also working on a lot of batteries. We are very familiar with all kinds of batteries. We need to really understand what do we bring in. Our expertise, do we have a new kind of battery? Is our lithium ion batteries superior than what is available anywhere else? Is our charging better? Are we able to do cell balancing better? Is our cost lower? Because the very cost, these are all cost sensitive things. We are working with a number of companies in looking at this. In fact, with the electric vehicle also we are working on. And is it the number of charge cycles, charging, discharging? Are we improving? If you're not bringing any new technology, well, then I don't know what we can do. So we can discuss where are we bringing something new. Where are we bringing something new and get again. We have very good understanding of what does a cost, say, final cost of battery per unit of electricity is. I calculated 17 rupees. I calculated for many others who are in the market, the 25 rupees. What is the great point in using a 25 rupees for a lithium per unit battery? I'll rather go for something which is cheaper. So we can again discuss that.
Yeah, I just want to point out that before I ask Mr. Sudeep Jain, that when he started, he mentioned that we actually had originally proposed DC appliances and DC microgrid in the home and solar as a way of going to consuming less power and being more efficient and as a way of decentralized generation. And the question Mr. Umashankar asked us was, why will people invest in this? Though we are able to show that there's a payback, but there's a 7-year payback, 6-year payback. So, Indian consumers with the kind of cost of money and, with the shortage of money, why will they do it? That was really the... So, there was a payback. It was not as if it wasn't a payback. So, then what was challenge thrown to us was, can you create a bigger demand pool, which solves an immediate pressing problem? So what you see here is that an approach is taken where this is not a solution for a temporary problem. It's always better to go for solar. It's always better to go for DC appliances as a permanent, not as a reversible thing. Okay? They make economic sense in their own way. But it will make additional sense for you to do it very quickly and put in the investment because the opportunity cost is very high otherwise. If it can also solve the current problem of what's caused by the power cut. That was what was brought in as a demand pool. Okay, Mr. Jain.
So one at the outset, let me tell you the reason I raised some of those questions. In fact, a couple of questions I had the answers, but I raised it because I want this center to debate lot of such issues beyond the technology issues. Because many of the times we have not been able to roll out solutions which are very clear that yes, technologically these solutions should work, have been working in the labs, but behavior patterns of the society, that also has to be part of the technology policy interface in the debate. So that's the reason I raised some of those points. I would want more and more such points to be thought of and debated. I'll only answer one question which you had raised about how to support or encourage pilots which startups and entrepreneurs like you come up with? Now, I don't think it is easy to do that from the government side directly, because for every good entrepreneur or NGO who comes with a good project and a good intention, there are 10 more who will come with completely wrong intentions, and they will ask for the same kind of support. So it will become, and we do not have, I'm saying, as government, we do not have the technical knowledge to evaluate and find out whether you are good and the other person is bad. So only way this can happen is if parks like this, institutions like this, incubators like this are able to support. Maybe government can fund the center here, and then the center can find out which is a better technology to encourage, try it out, do the pilots, and then later it can be rolled out. Thank you.
Let's, he has a flight to catch, then we'll continue. He has a flight to catch, I think it's exclusive. Thank you very much.
We'll continue for another 5 to 10 minutes and then we'll wind it up. Yes, sir. Yeah, Swami, first of all, because he has...
I think Professor Srinivasan is in waiting.
Oh, sorry. Please, go ahead.
No, please, sir.
I didn't see it.
I want to pursue the point which you made about the cost of capital being high for individuals and so on. So this means that you have to do more than illustrative calculations that Ashok put up about cost of various things. You have to calculate the internal rate of return.
Oh, we have done that.
Yes, absolutely. And compare it with the market rates of interest. The second thing is you have to distinguish between the private investment and private costs, and social investment and social costs. So the social cost benefit analysis has to go with along with the private decision making. My other point is other point was raised by the gentleman from our electricity company. Now that's the question of delaying needed reforms to change the supply, permanently remove the scarcity of electricity. Now, we have gone through this in many, many contexts. I'll take one other instance, that is legal reform. Take, for example, the delays in court system that have been with us for decades, and law commission reports have pointed out to this also for decades, and nothing happened. What have we done instead? We have put it in special tribunals and special courts for dealing with problems which should have been dealt with the normal court system. So creation of special tribunals in effect delays what you should do for the legal system as a whole, and that danger is very much there, that you think you have solved the immediate problem and forget about the addressing the more serious problem. This is a danger that we should be aware of and address if we can.
Yes, I think the cost calculations have to be done. We have done some, but we can do a better job, and that's probably one of the things we'll do in CTAP. Regarding the other one, we just addressed it, sir. We discussed it. See, the going over to DC appliances and adding solar local generation and augmenting your resources is in the right direction, even to achieve surplus power situation. It's not counter. Unlike the tribunals, it's not going to delay that. It's actually going to accelerate that. And even once you get into a situation where there are no power cuts, it still makes sense to have these appliances, and still makes sense to have a DC microgrid. So it's not something that is counter to what should be done. So in fact, if you remember what he said, is we actually wanted to see how to introduce these in order to address the power problem by becoming more efficient and by generating our own power locally in a fashion which is economically makes sense to the consumer. But what was pointed out was these investments in the Indian context have a long payback period. and consumers will not be willing to do that. You have to create one more huge demand pool for them to be willing to do that. Okay, and that is what we have done now by saying it will also address the power shortage problem. Okay, but really, it anyway makes sense for the consumer to go in this direction, makes sense for the country to go in this direction, because this will enable us to become power surplus or power sufficient earlier rather than later. That's it. We can discuss it later. Yeah. Swami.
Swami?
You said K.K. Raman has to go, is it?
He has to also.
My name is Swaminathan. On a larger context, we talk about energy per se. I certainly welcome these ideas of DC power supply. But if you look at the technologies, what you are proposing, basically as pointed out, is highly urban centric. And even within the urban centric approach, I think that what we are looking at is a kind of very highly distributed kind of consumer base, which would have very serious issues of the investment limits. Within this, I was just wondering, if instead of looking at individual domestic consumers, if we can target for the same kind of solutions that we're talking about, fans and lights, if buildings like large institutional buildings, which consume large amount, and where it is probably easier to implement for maybe even little cost intensive solutions, and then meant to switch over to this kind of technologies, it might be possible to implement it more easily rather than targeting individual consumers. That is one thing I thought. That even within an urban centric problem, the stakeholders you should probably target is somewhat different from then talking to general public, which may find it very difficult to, particularly in terms of the payback periods. This is one point. The second point is, I have come across, I don't know how many of you are aware, the Rain Center, there was a meeting recently where one of the companies have come out with systems which operate both on AC and DC, hybrid systems, so which also use the solar. So during the daytime, they have gone to even air conditioners, so they have lights, fans, and air conditioners and refrigerators, small, not very high power ones, the lower small power ones, and they have moved on to that, and I think they are also looking at this. But again, same point I made there also, in the sense that individual domestic consumers are probably more difficult to convince, even in spite of all the awareness campaigns. The third point, I think, which probably is requires a little different kind of understanding. All energy policies are not standalone policies. Energy policies are extremely interwoven with environmental policies. Unless and until we have the current environmental policies are highly favored towards centralized power generation. So unless there is a simultaneous interest in changing the environmental policies to proactively push for decentralized power generation, then only renewables have a very serious role to play. And that's going to be a very major decisive factor, because environmental policies are also automatically interwoven with health policies. There are several other issues which will come, even in terms of employment and things like that. All those things come into play. So you need to look at this, even though this may be technology solutions, in terms of policies, unless those policies are also coming into place together, we probably may not be able, we may be able to develop only short solutions.
Okay, solution. We are running out of time, so maybe K.K. Raman, you want to say something before we, do you have anything to add? Okay. I think, first of all, I think as Professor Jhunjhunwala mentioned, this is not there's nothing in the solution that's urban-centric. It works for rural areas also. What you might say is, where is the investment capacity in the rural area? That might be a question you're asking.
When you look at the rural, fans and lights in rural areas are not really a very serious issue.
Okay.
Most of the rural housing designs are not dependent on that. In fact, they can probably, even if the daytime, if there is a power failure, they can live a little more comfortably than us. It's mainly the urban building design.
No, that's okay. That's okay. But I think, certainly institutions can, are the easy, because there are many, most of the schools and colleges are all government owned, and they can in fact afford the long payback period. That's a no-brainer. That didn't require all this, innovations. But you'll be surprised as the number of, at least in some of the states, I don't know about all the states in the country, you'll be surprised at the number of households that now have fans and lights in rural areas, and how dependent they are even on mixies to work before they go out in the morning. All the, people who are going out to work, the women who are going out to work at 8 o'clock in the morning now need the mixie to work before they leave, because they have to give the food to their kid. Things have changed dramatically, but those who don't have anything, of course, for them this makes no. I mean, I agree with you, if you don't need electricity, why, what do you care? Whether it's, available, or if you're not able to afford electricity, what does it matter to you whether it's available, in with cuts or without cuts? I agree with you. But the number of people who now need this is much larger even in rural areas. So I think the other thing whatever you said is right. I mean, but I presume that going towards energy efficient appliances and energy solar energy is in the right direction. But it turns out that solar photovoltaics is becoming, if you're going to generate it and use it immediately right there, it's becoming competitive with grid power even without incentives, even without environmental policies helping it today. That's the way the technology has gone. If you want DC power in the day, and you don't want, and the grid power is not good, you don't care. You can generate it yourself, and it's cheaper. Yes, you need some, you need to invest, but you have to invest in whatever amount is proportional. If you want 25 watts, you can invest for 25 watts. You don't need to invest for 1 kilowatt. If you are going to do that, if you're going to feed to the grid, there's a problem. But if you're just going to consume yourself, you can just generate 25 watts and consume it. Okay, thank you. Last, yeah.
See, one point that we have to understand is that the consumer aspirations is not a constant. It's a continuously varying thing. If a customer doesn't have something today, he aspires for something. The moment that is made available, his aspiration goes to another level. Then he expects that to be permanently present and so on. So that's where it goes. So today the rural households may be okay living without power, but once they get used to power, their aspirations will change. So it's important.
Our own work in rural areas pretty much shows that, at least in Tamil Nadu, everyone wants power. They want power, they are dependent on lights, they are dependent on fans. In fact, they do all kinds of things. And I think we are probably a little bit, today 96% of our children are starting to go to school. This is, of course, shocking to most people who still believe it is 55-60. And I think they need power. They need power to study. In fact, this is one of the common complaints that everyone is. And providing uninterrupted power is, so while I agree with Swami on, we are, for example, planning to use in this building and several other building, institutional builders who can use DC lights and fans. We are planning to do that. But giving uninterrupted power to homes, particularly low-income homes, is so important. I didn't want to contradict Sudeep, because my own peon says that yes, power goes today 2-3 hours a day in Chennai, and they are not comfortable. They are not at all comfortable.
No, they said it is there everywhere.
I mean, I think it's sometime we just start talking that there are no power cuts.
And becoming power surplus means burning more coal, which is quite terrible.
Okay, I think we'll now conclude this discussion, and what we hope we've given you is a flavor of what the kind of multidisciplinary issues that the center will grapple with. On the one side, it has to understand very deep issues of technology. For example, to address the question that Professor Srinivasan asked, are you doing a solution which is actually going to hinder the, what is the right long-term solution? So the answer to that comes from a deep understanding of technology, that actually using these kind of DC appliances is actually permanently the right thing to do, okay? Even if you had surplus power today, that would be the right direction to go, okay? It should replace all the, that's why people said you should replace incandescent bulbs with CFLs, and you should replace, now you're saying you should replace CFLs with LEDs, same reason. The second thing is what about the payback periods and the investments and all that, and that those calculations should be done. So these are economics, technology, social behavior,
You know, for all you know, the lowest of the homes, if this becomes, if it becomes very popular or successful, the next election, somebody may announce that they'll give a fan and a light to everybody. They can give a mixie, why can't they give that? So, to every home. So basically, I mean, these are all, there are solutions for all these things. It doesn't even involve payback periods. Okay? So, I think, you know, the center has to understand really all, you know, deal with all of these, the economics, the technology, the behavioral issues, the interplay of all of this. And as Mr. Sudeep Jain pointed out, governments have the limits in what policies they can take. They can't take big risks. We saw that in 1914 also, you know, let's wait. Let's wait till it's proven. Let's not do anything. You know, let's not take any risks. Who knows whether this electricity will work, right? And so this is the same thing you're saying today. We can't take any big risks. We can't defend it if we do a big thing and it's a flop. So this is all the same issue. So they need that whole trajectory of how do you take something from here to there to a success, you know. So Mr. Chandrasekhar talked about that just by one swift flip in the policy in 1999, they were able to unleash this telecom thing without any risk to the government, because if it failed, it failed. They were not investing. Okay? They just changed it to revenue sharing mode. But that was a very intelligent, you know, understanding, and they earned revenue also. Right? It's only that later on they figured out, can we earn more revenue, that all the trouble started. Right? Not because they didn't earn revenue. So it's a greed from the government side, revenue earning side, if you want to call it that, that caused the problems in telecom sector post 2008. So really, this whole interplay is what this center wants to deal with. It's very difficult to describe it in one sentence. So we thought by having this kind of discussion, we'll give a feel for what this center, even to ourselves, or what this center has to deal with. Thank you very much for your patience, and I hope you enjoyed it. We'll now just give mementos to the remaining panelists, and we'll wind up the session. Thank you for attending.
Thank you. Before I thank everyone, I request our director to present this memento to Mr. K.K. Raman. And a memento to our Professor Ashok. So thank you on behalf of everyone here. I would like to thank our chief guest Sri Chandrasekhar for delivering the inaugural lecture. Thank our director for chairing the panel, and also the panelists Ashok Jhunjhunwala, Professor Ashok Jhunjhunwala, Sri K.K. Raman, and Sri Sudeep Jain for enlightening us on the solar energy sector in particular and their own work. Thank all participants, faculty, students, members of Research Park. I'd like to thank those who came from outside the campus, in particular those from government. Thank the press for their presence and covering the event, and the staff and office bearers of Research Park, particularly Mr. Muta and his team. I thank the photographic section and CCE for covering the event, and Mr. Vinay Naik, who has made the tea and snacks possible. And please join us for tea outside. And above all, particularly for those for staying back for an extended time of nearly 1 hour as part of this event. Thank you very much. Thank you.
3:30 we're supposed to.
3 hours. Okay, sorry, about an hour. Thank you. Thank you very much. Yeah.